Hello friends, welcome to this video session. In this video session, we are going to deal about gene regulation in prokaryotes. I am going to discuss about the Lac Operon concept. So before diving into the topic, what does this actually mean? Gene regulation in prokaryotes. So we all know what are prokaryotes. They are the most primitive organism. Pro means primitive, karyon means nucleus. So they have the most primitive nucleus, which is not very well developed, and they do not have any nuclear envelope or the nuclear membrane. They are naked in nature. And how does the gene regulate in them? So what is, we all know the central dogma of molecular biology, where a single DNA strand, it has huge number of genomes or the nucleotide bases. They undergo transcription to form a single-stranded mRNA molecule. That mRNA molecule is translated with the help of ribozymes to form the protein molecule, which is the product of that particular gene. So this pathway is called as gene regulation. So if you see in the prokaryotes, there are two methods or two entire processes called as Lac operon concept and the tryptophan operon concept. These two concepts are very well studied and very well experimented. Hence, these two is mainly conserved in every part. We are concentrating only on these two things. So first, we'll be studying about the Lac operon concept. Lac means it is the short form for lactose. So lactose is a disaccharide. So how this experiment was done in E. coli or Escherichia coli. So how this E. coli or how this bacteria consumes the lactose and how it is broken down, that metabolism, that catabolic process is called as Lac operon concept. So what do you mean by operon? The name itself says. So Lac operon, we should be clear with the name first. Lac indicates lactose. Operon. Operon means it is a cluster of gene. We have number of genes over here. These cluster of genes or collection of genes or group of genes are called as operon. So using this operon or using this cluster of genes, how the lactose is catabolized is called as Lac operon concept. So it was studied in E. coli. It was studied by two great scientists called as Jacob and Monod in the year 1961, and they received the Nobel Prize in the year 1965. This is just a very brief history. So moving on to this concept, as I said, operon means a cluster of gene or a collection of gene. So operon can be broadly categorized into two group of gene. One is called as a controlling gene, because this is called as controlling, the name itself indicates it controls the other gene. So this group is called as controlling gene and this group is called as structural gene. So the operon can be broadly categorized into two groups, the controlling gene and the structural gene. Controlling gene, the name, because it controls the other gene. This controlling gene is further broken down into different set of genes. So it is mainly broken down into three classes or three groups. That is your regulatory gene, which is indicated by I, promoter gene, which is indicated by P, and operator gene, which is indicated by O. In many of the textbooks, they give concentration to this three region. But going a step deep, there is also a small region called as cap site, which is also included under this controlling gene. So for second year PUC student or BAC student, if you mention just IPO, it is enough. But for master's and students, you have to mention about this cap region also, cap site region also. So this controlling gene, it has regulatory gene or regulatory site, which is represented by I, cap site, promoter region and operator region. Now coming to on its function, this regulatory gene, the name itself says regulate. Regulation means control. It controls this entire Lac operon. So the product that is obtained from this gene controls this entire operon. Hence it is called as regulatory gene or the regulatory site. It produces repressor mRNA. It produces, this regulatory site produces repressor mRNA. I am drawing mRNA like this because it is a single stranded structure molecule. This repressor mRNA, it gives rise to the repressor protein. Repressor protein or suppressor protein. This protein represses or suppresses. What do you mean by represses or suppresses? it controls this lac operon. It suppresses the lac operon. It has a negative regulation. This is the function of this regulatory site. This cap site, it is a region where the cap proteins bind to it. I'll come to it later. What is cap proteins? How do they bind? I'll come to it later. So cap site, it is a region where the cap proteins bind to it. Hence the name cap site. Promoter region is the region where the RNA polymerase binds. So these genes, these are genes, right? This I is a gene, cap site is a gene, P is a gene, O is a gene. These all are some group of genes. Where will genes be present? Genes will be present on the DNA. So this entire structure is found in the DNA. So you can consider one as 3 prime, the other one as 5 prime. It is all found in the DNA. So this RNA polymerase, whenever transcription should occur, RNA polymerase is required. RNA polymerase comes and binds to this promoter region. That is very important. So promoter region is a binding site for RNA polymerase for the transcription to occur. What is transcription? Transcription is nothing but the double-stranded DNA is converted to single-stranded mRNA. That's as simple as that. Next is the operator region or operator gene. What does this do? This acts as a switch. This is very important. It is a binding site for this repressor protein. If this repressor protein binds over to this operator region, the entire process aborts or gets stopped, terminated. If this repressor protein does not bind to this operator region, then this operon, this lac operon concept goes on. This metabolism process continues. Transcription, translation, everything occurs. So this operator region is very, very important. It acts as a switch based on whether the operator region is free or it is occupied by the repressor protein. The next thing is whether the lac operon is happening or it has terminated, we can come to know. So this is a binding region for this repressor protein or suppressor protein that is produced by the regulatory gene site. So this is about the controlling gene. This is one group of operon. We have another group of operon called as structural gene. They are of three types: LacZ, LacY, LacA. So LacZ is that gene. It gives a very important enzyme called as beta-galactosidase. Beta-galactosidase. This LacZ, it transcribes an important protein enzyme molecule called as beta-galactosidase. Now, what is the function of beta-galactosidase? Beta-galactosidase, it involves the breaking down of lactose molecule. So, lactose is a disaccharide molecule. It is broken down and it splits and gives rise to two monosaccharide units. One is glucose, the other one is galactose. Hence, the name beta-galactosidase. So, it involves in the breaking down of lactose molecule into glucose and galactose. That is a function of beta-galactosidase. That is produced by the enzyme gene LacZ. Next, coming to LacY, it transcribes another enzyme called as beta-galactoside permease. Permease, what is the function of permease? It permits, it allows the entry of lactose into the E. coli cells. So, E. coli cell wall will be there, right? Ductal cell wall. It is semi-permeable. It does not allow all the molecules to come in. So, this beta-galactoside permease, that is transcribed by LacY gene. The name permease itself, it says, it permits, it allows, it makes the lactose enter into the bacterial cell. Okay, that is a function of beta-galactoside permease. Now, the last gene, LacA. This LacA produces an enzyme, beta-galactoside transacetylase. So, transacetylase, it transfers acetyl group. So, from where to where? Acetyl group is transferred from acetyl coenzyme A, it is transferred to lactose molecule. So this transferring of acetyl molecule, this principle is the, since this is a function of the enzyme transacetylase. So it takes the acetyl molecule from acetyl coenzyme A and it gives it to lactose and prevents from exit of that lactose molecule. That lactose molecule which enters in might go out also, right? So, when this acetyl group is added to this lactose, now the lactose cannot leave the cell. It has to stay inside the cell. It blocks the outflow of the lactose molecule. So, that is the function of this galactoside transacetylase. So, now this is the structure of operon. This can be asked for 2 marks, then you have to just mention the names. If it is asked for 5 marks, you have to draw the structure and explain the each function and each region. This is the structure of operon. Now let us see how the mechanism occurs or how the regulation occurs. So now what happens? So if you grow the E. coli, let us consider this as an E. coli. It is growing in a growth medium. If in the growth medium glucose is present, this is the most favorable source of energy for this E. coli. For us, the most favorable source of energy is rice, wheat, such fruits and vegetables, right? So whichever is simple in structure, which is not much complex, which can be easily digested, we consume them. Similarly, these E. coli also, they take simple molecules such as glucose, because they are monosaccharide unit, they can be easily ingested into them. So they are the most favorable source of energy. So glucose is the most favorable source of energy for this E. coli. In the absence of glucose, lactose is taken. In the absence of glucose, lactose is taken and it undergoes this lac operon concept to break down this lactose, and then it consumes the glucose that is formed as the split product of lactose. Right? This is disaccharide residue. It splits into form glucose and galactose. After splitting this lactose molecule, it consumes that glucose that is formed. So this is the main aim. Why this entire operon thing happens? To convert this, in the absence of glucose, to convert this lactose into glucose and galactose. Now what happens is, in the absence of glucose, when the glucose is very low, when the concentration of glucose is very low, there is a secondary messenger called as CAMP, cyclic. C stands for cyclic adenosine monophosphate. We have ATP, GTP, and all, right? Adenosine triphosphate, adenosine monophosphate. We have only one phosphate group, and the structure will be cyclic in nature. Hence, cyclic adenosine monophosphate. In the absence of glucose, or when there is low levels of glucose, CAMP is produced. These are secondary messengers. They are like signal molecules. They signal them. They signal this operon should happen. This operon should start now. Glucose is not there in the medium. Lactose should be taken and should be broken down. So these act as signaling molecule. Hence we call them as secondary messengers. This CAMP is produced. As I said you, there are some proteins called as CAP proteins. CAP proteins, the full form of CAP is catabolite gene activator proteins. So these are nothing but group of proteins. They go on activate the gene. Hence the name catabolite. This is catabolism process, right? Breaking down is catabolism. The lactose is broken down. Hence the name is catabolite gene activator protein. They call as CAP proteins. These CAP proteins and this CAMP, they combine together to form a CAP-CAMP complex. So this CAP proteins and secondary messenger called a CAMP, they both combine together to form a CAP, C-A-P, CAP and CAMP, CAP-CAMP complex. This complex goes and binds to the CAP site. As I said, you know, the CAP site, that is the site for the binding of CAP protein. So this complex now goes and binds to this CAP site. When this complex goes and binds to the CAP site, it stabilizes the RNA polymerase. This RNA polymerase, it comes and attaches to the promoter region. It sees that this RNA polymerase does not fall down. It stabilizes and it initiates the operon concept. It initiates the transcription to occur. So it is very important. You have to remember this process. So in the absence of glucose, or when there is a low level of glucose, CAMP secondary messengers are produced that form a complex with the CAP proteins, and they go and bind to this CAP site and they stabilize the RNA polymerase and they initiate this operon concept. So have this in your mind. Now we will go what happens when glucose is present, what happens when glucose is absent. Only two things you are going to study over here. When glucose is present. So now glucose is present in the medium. What happens when glucose is present in the medium? So this regulatory gene, I gene, it produces an mRNA. This mRNA produces a repressor protein. repressor protein, or it is also called as suppressor protein. Now what happens? This repressor protein goes and binds onto the operator region. It goes and binds to the operator region. This repressor protein or suppressor protein that is produced by the transcription of the regulatory gene in the absence of glucose goes and binds to the operator region and it blocks the transcription of RNA polymerase. RNA polymerase is present in this promoter region. RNA polymerase is present in this promoter region. What happens? It acts like a mountain. It is huge, bulky in nature. It does not allow the flow of RNA polymerase. So RNA polymerase cannot move through this and it cannot transcribe. It cannot read these things. So transcription does not occur. So these enzymes are not produced. I said LacZ produces this enzyme, LacY produces this, LacA produces this. Because of the RNA polymerase should go there, it should transcribe, it should produce RNA. That RNA will produce that enzyme, right? Here, because of this bulky nature or because of this huge suppressor protein going and binding to this operator region, it does not allow the RNA polymerase to move through it and the transcription does not occur. As a result, there is no enzyme produced and lactose is not taken. It is said that this lac operon is switched off. It is called a switch off mechanism. So glucose is present in the medium. When glucose is present, why should E. coli take the lactose? Why should it break down and why should it consume? It's waste of time and waste of energy. To conserve that energy, it takes this negative regulation takes place over here. So when the glucose is high, as I said, only when the glucose is low or the glucose is absent, CAMP is produced. Here the glucose is very high, so there is no CAMP production, there is no complex formation, so there is no binding to this capsid, hence it does not stabilize this RNA polymerase and it does not initiate this lac operon. This lac operon is said to be switched off. There is no enzyme synthesis, there is no transcription, there is nothing happening over here. So whatever glucose is there, that E. coli will consume and stay happily. This is when the glucose is present. Now when the glucose is absent, when the glucose is absent or when the glucose is in very few, what happens? Very few concentration, what happens? Let us see. So this gene will be like that itself, right? This operator gene, nothing will affect to this operator gene. So as usual, this regulatory gene, I gene, it produces mRNA. This mRNA produces repressor protein. Now what is happening is, lactose is present in the medium. Lactose is present in the medium. This lactose, it is present in the form of isoform called as allolactose. Called as allolactose. Lactose means, it doesn't mean lactose is present like that only. It is present in the isoform called as isolactose. This isolactose acts as an inducer. So this inducer goes and binds to this repressor now. So this, as usual, it produces mRNA, the regulatory gene. That mRNA again transcribes and translates to form a repressor protein or a suppressor protein. This lactose, it is present in the form of isolactose or present in its isoform called as allolactose. This allolactose acts as an inducer and it goes and binds to this repressor molecule forming repressor inducer complex. Repressor is the repressor protein. Inducer is there. Inducer is nothing but allolactose. So this inducer goes and binds to this repressor forming repressor inducer complex. Now when this complex is formed, there are some conformational changes and it conformationally changes this molecule such a way that it cannot bind to the operator gene. So when this isoform of lactose, that is allolactose, is not present, when inducer is not present, this goes and binds over here. When this goes, when lactose is present, it goes and binds to this and it forms a repressor inducer complex. And this repressor inducer complex changes conformationally and it changes such a way that it cannot go and bind to the operator gene. Now the operator gene is free. It has given green signal for this RNA polymerase to go. There is no hurdle or there is no any blockage over there. So this RNA polymerase can go now and it can transcribe this and it can convert all this gene into mRNA, and this all this mRNA can be converted into proteins or enzyme. So beta-galactosidase, beta-galactoside permease, beta-galactoside transacetylase, all the enzymes will be produced and the lactose will be taken into the cell and it will be transacetylated. Then it will be broken down, glucose and galactose will be released, so that will be consumed by the E. coli. That happens in the presence, in the absence of glucose when lactose is present. Hence, it is called as switch on mechanism. If glucose is absent and lactose is present, it is called a switch on mechanism. If glucose is present and lactose is absent, it is called a switch off mechanism. And one more thing you have to remember over here is, when the lactose is present, glucose is entirely absent or it is present in very low concentration. So what happens? CAMP secondary messengers are produced. These combined with CAP proteins to form CAMP CAP complex. They go and bind to this CAP site. They stabilize the polymerase enzyme. They prevent it from falling down. And they assist in the transcription and they initiate the transcription. So during when the glucose is absent, these also happen simultaneously. And it enhances the production of this Lac operon. So this is the how metabolic activities occur. This Lac operon is called as an inducible operon. This is very important. It is called as an inducible operon. If they may be asked for 2 marks, why it is called as inducible operon? Why it is called as inducible operon? Because this Lac operon is dependent on this inducer called as allolactose. Only in the presence of allolactose, that is inducer, it is switched on. In the absence of allolactose, this is switched off because this goes and binds over here and blocks. So it is completely dependent on this inducer. So hence it is called as inducible operon. Whereas on the other hand, in the tryptophan operon is also there, that I'll be dealing in another video. Please do watch that also. That is called as a repressible operon. We'll come to that later. So this is called as an inducible operon. So I hope this Lac operon concept is very simple and clear. In the absence of glucose, how the E. coli cells take the lactose, that is how the Jacob and Monod had explained. So please do, if you have any doubts or comments, you can pass it into my comments, and you can please subscribe my channel. Please post your valuable comments. I'll try to change. Thank you.